Good morning. It is so good to see a bunch of smiling faces in this audience, and I know it's going to even sound better today when you're all singing. All right, would you stand as we worship together this morning?
To God be the glory. Great things he has done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life an atonement for sin and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord.
Psalm 136 says, "Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Give thanks to the God of gods, for his steadfast love endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord of lords, for his steadfast love endures forever. To him who alone does great wonders, for his steadfast love endures forever. To him who by understanding made the heavens, for his steadfast love endures forever." Aren't you thankful this morning for his steadfast love? Last week we looked at this couple that's up here on the screen now, and we prayed for them. I want us to look at the next slide this morning about a website called PrayForPlanters.com. So we've been doing an emphasis on praying for the North American Mission Board and their missionaries, and this is what it says about this website. PrayForPlanners.com is a website created to connect church planners with prayer partners. Planners share the specific needs of their families, churches, and neighborhoods, and believers can register to pray for these requests. Pray More believers will commit to pray for church planners and their communities across North America. So as a church, we've decided that this is somewhere we want to focus our prayer during this year. And so I would encourage you to also check out this website, and you can find more specific prayer requests from church planners. Also, I just want us to pray this morning for all of the missionaries who we have already prayed for and the ones we haven't, and their churches as they worship this morning. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for the opportunity that we have to come together and worship you. And I thank you for the resources we have here that we can come together as one body. Lord, I pray for the church planters who you've sent out all around the United States and North America. I pray for their churches this morning, for their leadership as they lead out in these new churches. I pray that as the church planters minister to their community, that your gospel would be spread throughout those areas. I pray that as a church who is praying for those people, you would show us how we can continue to reach them, continue to encourage the missionaries around North America. Thank you for everything you've blessed us with. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Stand as we continue to worship together this morning.
Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel His mighty power and
seated.
Thank y'all. That's awesome. I think we would be remiss if we didn't stop and have prayer right now just to acknowledge the holiness of our God that we're here to worship together today. Let's pray together. Father, this is a special day in the fact that we've come to dedicate some children to you and to be in a time of baptism. But Lord, the ultimate reason we're here for those items is because we stand before a holy and righteous God. And so, Lord, right now we just stop to celebrate, to acknowledge, to affirm that you're holy and righteous and perfect and awesome. And so, Lord, during this time, we lift up your name and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, this is a special day. We're doing two special things outside normal. We're dedicating four children to the Lord, and then we're going to baptize three men at the end of the service. And normally, I do those in separate services, but today, Jake, one of the fathers, wanted to be baptized. So what more appropriate thing than to be baptized and dedicate your child the same day? Amen? So those of you who are going to dedicate a child today, if y'all would come stand here kind of facing me in front of the communion table, and I would extend this invitation. If there's any of you who are grandparents of these children, want to come stand behind the couples, you're welcome and invited to do so. And so y'all come, all of you, and stand here. And I'm going to give these couples a copy of this little dedication service, and they will repeat this. Congregation, I invite you, though, and y'all just face me, parents and grandparents, all of you. And then we're going to do this together. Congregation, in a few minutes, I'm going to ask you to do a part as a part of the body of Christ. And grandparents, y'all come on and get behind so we identify who's with who here. Thank y'all so much. Y'all didn't know y'all was getting into this today, did you? But thank you for being here together today. Now, I'm going to read a call to commitment. These couples will share first. And y'all just say, "We do," when I ask. And then, grandparents, y'all can say that with them, because the way I see this is a family affair. And then in a few minutes, when I get to it, I'll ask you as a church to affirm as well by standing. But for now, congregation, y'all remain seated. And we'll ask this special group of families to dedicate these children to the Lord. First question, do you families desire earnestly that your child should grow up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord? Do you covenant together as families to strive to bring your child a knowledge of the Scriptures, to ever teach your child loving, obedient reverence for God and for His Son, Jesus Christ, and to use all the ministries of the church to accomplish this end? As you dedicate this child today, do you desire to dedicate yourselves as families to Christ and the church, that you may live exemplary lives and so living may present and commend Christ to your child from this day forward? Congregation, this is for you to respond to. Do you, as a member of the church, or we would refer to it otherwise as the body of Christ, promise to join these families in the teaching and training of these children, that they may be led in due time to trust Christ as Lord and Savior and to confess Him in baptism and church membership? If you will accept this responsibility, will you indicate it by standing? And I might add to that, put them on your prayer list and do that. I have a prayer of dedication. I told the parents, I just kind of want to read this today. It's coming from my heart, and it's coming from their heart, and I want them to be able to put this into their baby book, and they'll have it from now on, what we prayed, what we said today. So if you would, bow your heads in prayer. Our Father, you're the giver of all life. You're our Savior and our sustainer of all families. I ask you to bless these parents that wait before you with the guidance and wisdom for the task of rearing their children. I pray that they will experience your continuing undergirding as they tenderly love, care for, and train the children you have given them. Grant them patience when frustration presses in. Give them wisdom in confronting the perplexities of parenthood. Father, I ask you to bless these children, even as their mothers hold them and their fathers stand with them also. Protect them from the ravages of the world's hate, wars, and rejection. Keep them for thy sake. In Jesus' name, amen. Congregation, y'all can be seated. And let me come down here. And I want to give each one of you a copy of this pledge you're making today. I actually should give you two. And here's one for you. We are short a couple of certificates. We'll have to get these to them later. But Jake and Elena Sutherland and their daughter is Finley. Y'all kind of turn around so everybody can gloat over your child today, all right? And the Patrick and Beth Carlisle, and this is James Carlisle, and here's a certificate of dedication in the New Testament. And Brett and Heather Tucker, I've got the New Testaments, but I don't have the certificate, so I apologize. We'll get them to y'all. So y'all turn around, face the congregation, and the whole congregation can gloat together. And all God's people said, amen. And just give them a hand. All right. Thank you so much. All right. Y'all can be seated. And thank you for this. It's such an honor to be able to participate with them and be a part of this today. And you as a church, remember to pray for them as parents. They would have the wisdom and the courage and the strength they need as parents, but also stand beside them during this time. Grandparents, thank you so much for being here together today as well. Now, we sang a couple of songs to honor the Lord, and we're about to sing another one. But in the process of this song, our deacons will come and take up our morning offering. And I say this as a teaching thing every Sunday. We don't ask people to give just to be given. And if you're a guest today, we don't ask you to give. We do this as members of Buell Baptist Church because it's our way of saying, God, you're holy and you deserve all things. So as our deacons come, we drop our tithes into the offering plate, and we're going to have a word of prayer. And Stacy, you lead us in another song. Deacons, if y'all would come, please. And let's pray together. Glenn, would you voice this prayer, please, sir? Amen. Thank you.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. Jesus, till every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom, I speak Jesus. Your name is power, your name is healing, your name through the shadows, burn like a fire. I just want to speak. Jesus. Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. Break every stronghold. Shine through the shadows. Burn like a fire. Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. Break every stronghold. Shine through the shadows. Burn like a fire.
Would you stand with us as we finish singing?
Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name. Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name. Jesus. I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
Dear Jesus, we just come to you this morning, Father, and we're just so thankful for your presence, Lord. And we're thankful that when we speak your name, that the enemy has to flee, Father, and that he can't reside where you reside, Lord. And we are just thankful for that safe place in you, Jesus, Lord. And I just ask that this morning, as Brother Tim comes, that you just pour your Holy Spirit upon him and speak through him, Father. Lord, we just love you so much. We give you all the glory, honor, and praise for what you're going to do in this place today. Amen.
Thank y'all for that. If you have a copy of God's Word, either on your phone or if you have a Bible in your hands, turn to Hebrews chapter 11. We've celebrated with Jake and Elena Sullivan and little Finley and Patrick and Beth and little James. And I intended to say something about this earlier, Brett and Heather Tucker. And they have their newest one, Millie. And Grayson is 5 years old, but they never had been able to go through a dedication service with him. So I commend them for doing that. And I invite any of you other parents who may have children, if you've never been able to go through a dedication time with them, you're invited and encouraged to do that, and we'll try to include that in their lives. So thank you so much for being here today. Hebrews chapter 11. I'm going to make one announcement now, and Tyler will touch on some more in a few minutes. But tonight, we're starting a new ministry focus on the fourth Sunday night of every month. And tonight I'm going to answer questions and go over the details of that and what that means and what it looks like and allow you a chance to understand better about that. So we'll be here at 5:45 to go over that. Years ago, I saw a quote that they're about to put on the screen that I never have forgotten. It says, "The hand that rocks the cradle is the hand that rules the world." Just kind of ponder on that for a minute. The hand that rocks the cradle is the hand that rules the world. How many of y'all believe that besides me? Do you believe that the hand that rocks the cradle is the hand that rules the world? And fathers, that's not leaving y'all out. That's included y'all in the bargain. And I'll today what I want to do for just a few minutes before we come to baptize these three men, I want to speak to these couples, but every one of us this should apply to. What does it mean to be a world-changing parent? Now, in Hebrews 11, verse 23, we find an example of a couple that they dedicated their child to God, but actually what they did through him literally changed the world. By faith, Moses, Hebrews 11, 23, by faith, Moses, when he was born, here's your dedication part, was hidden for 3 months by his parents, because they saw that the child was beautiful and they were not afraid of the king's edict. Now, what I want to do is pull out three short principles that came from the life of Moses' parents for these couples, but also, I don't know about y'all, but as a follower of Jesus Christ, I want to be used of God to make a difference in my world. In fact, our church slogan says we want to make a difference in our world. So what was it about these two parents that these parents can mimic, but we also as believers can mimic in our world? So look at these, and they will flash these points up on the screen if you want to write them down. Number one, they made parenting a priority. And I might apply that to mine in your life. If you're a follower of Jesus Christ, is your faith in Jesus Christ a priority? Most of you know, and if you're a guest today, we had a son who was a missionary in China for 18 years, and his wife, Erica, is over in Taiwan now. But Erica would always say, "My job as a missionary wife is my children." Now, she's a marvelous evangelist. She's a marvelous teacher of the gospel to other people. And so here she was, she and David, overseas in China, and millions of people who had never heard the name Jesus before. But Erica made everybody know that her first priority as a mother was those children. And she made it a priority. So if I'm looking at this story about Moses from that vantage point, then I see that my job as a parent, and any of you in this room today, your first, if you are a parent, your priority, number one, is God. Number two, ought to be to your family. And so they did that with Moses. Now, there's two points I want you to see here in this verse of Scripture about making parenting a priority. Look at that verse. By faith, Moses, when he was born, was hidden for 3 months by his parents because they saw that he was beautiful. Now, notice two things there. They hid him for 3 months. Now, don't raise your hand on his parents, but I would dare say that there's not a parent in this room that had to hide your child after it was born for 3 months. Now, the reason for that was that there was a wicked king in Egypt named Pharaoh, and he had wanted to kill all the boy babies. And so they had to hide him for 3 months just to protect him. Now, after he was in all of us, if you've ever been to the Ten Commandments and seen that in the movies, you know that after 3 months, then Moses' mother had to make a little basket out of wicker or something like that, as we would know it, and then kind of put a type of mud around it to make it float. And then she hid him in what the Bible calls the bulrushes for another period of time. Now, she made protecting her son a priority. Sometimes I watch these little video clips on YouTube, and I saw one a few weeks ago I'll never forget. This this hen, this mother chicken, had a group of little chicks underneath her in a little cave area. And you see this python come slithering in, and you're thinking, he's wanting to get those baby chicks. And I never will forget what that mother chicken did, that hen did. She came out of that cave and fought that little python snake and tried to run it away. I thought, that's how mothers do. They protect their children and want to keep them from harm. And that's what Moses' mother and father did. They saw their job as parents was priority in raising that child. Now notice another phrase in that verse, and I kind of laugh at this. They hid him for 3 months because they saw the child was beautiful. Now don't raise your hand on this, but how many of you have ever seen a parent that said, that's the ugliest child I've ever seen in my life, baby-wise? They don't say that about their. Now they may look at somebody else's baby and said, that's an ugly baby. But there, if you don't, every parent thinks they've got the most beautiful child in the world. Now, here's an application I pull from that phrase. Moses' parents went the second mile to make sure that their son, Moses, was emotionally healthy by affirming his personality. Moms and dads, church members, Christians, it's our responsibility to build up babies and children and youth and young people to help them discover who they are created by God to be. And that's not always the case. And so in their lives, I mentioned this to our church a while back. There was an Alabama football player by the name of John Quarle who started a place up near Pell City, somewhere up in there, called the Big Oak Ranch. And he later wrote a book about his experience of dealing with those troubled teens there. And he wrote a book entitled, Winning Out the Winner in Your Child. In fact, parents, I would encourage you to get that book. It's got some outstanding principles about raising children. But what John Quarle set out to do at Big Oak Ranch, am I saying the right name for that? It is Big Oak Ranch. Yeah, okay. And what he set out to do was to help teenagers who were struggling to make it in life, and his priority was helping them to be confident in who they were as a person. And so I read this story one time about this little girl. She was, I think, 3 or 4 years old, and her daddy would always set up a date night with her. And so he carried his little girl out on a date night one Saturday night, and his strategy that night was he wanted to make his little girl feel special. So he sat there with her across the table from him, and he said, honey, I want you to know that you are beautiful and that in God's eyes you are a special little girl. She said, say it again, Daddy. And so he said, I want you to know that in God's eyes you're special and that you're created special and you're a beautiful little girl. And she said, say it again, Daddy. And he did it about 6 times. And that night when the little girl got home and the father and the mother said, well, how did the date go tonight? She said, it was special. Daddy told me I was beautiful, and Daddy told me that I was special. Now, I don't know what words we might use for that, but if I'm a parent, I want my children to grow up knowing they're beautiful. And, man, we don't use the word beautiful a whole lot in reference to the boys, but, you know, the thing that comes out of that, parenting was a priority, and parenting was a time for those parents to make Moses feel special. Now, remember, Moses was given the job by God to lead a couple of million Israelite people out of the land of Egypt to what was called the Promised Land. Now, think about this. George Washington had a mother. Abraham Lincoln had a mother. And I could go on and on talking about all the great men and women throughout history who went on to do a great function. Well, behind every great child, and Men, let's be honest about it. Behind every great man, there's a good woman. But behind every great child, especially, they've got to have a mom and daddy that affirms them and builds them up and makes them to feel that they are beautiful. Principle number one, moms and dads, your children are a priority. You can put ball on the back burner. I've talked to many fathers who said, when my kids were teenagers, I couldn't play sports, and I raised them up, and then I went back to sports. But I don't know how you do that, but I'm here to say to you, parents, grandparents, church members, all of us, parenting needs to be a priority. Now look at another phrase in this passage of Scripture today we're meditating on. By what Moses did, what did he do? By faith. These parents set an example of faith before Moses. Now, sometimes I, as a parent, especially when my boys were small, I asked myself, did they really see Jesus in me? You couples that came today, you've got a responsibility. I've got a responsibility. We as a church have a responsibility to show children faith. And can I just chase a little rabbit here for a second? A lot of people are under the impression that if I just bring my children to church from time to time and they know that we believe in God, that we've done our job. Friends, I may offend you by saying that, I'm going to tell you from the love of my heart. Your kids need to see you living your faith. They need to see you reading your Bible. They need to see you praying. You ought to have and those of you who came today, I would encourage y'all to set up a family altar time before you go to bed at night or whatever. But our children, listen, faith is caught more than it's taught. Say that with me. Faith is caught more than it's taught. Two people quoted it with me. Say that with me. Faith is caught more than it's taught. If you don't make your faith a priority, like I pointed out in principle number one, your children are going to pick up on that, and they're not going to learn from you just because you put an idea in their head. Moses' parents were people of faith, and that takes guts, and it takes courage, and it takes really being consistent in your spiritual lives. I heard about this school teacher one time told her kids, said, do y'all know who Jesus is? Yeah, we know who Jesus is. Where's he at right now? One little boy said, well, Jesus is in heaven. The teacher said, you're absolutely right. And then a little girl said, Jesus is in my heart. And the teacher said, that's absolutely right. And then the real kicker was this little boy. Every time you tell a joke about a boy, it's always Johnny for some reason. But then Johnny spoke up and said, Jesus is in our bathroom. The teacher thought, bathroom? He said, yeah, every morning when mom and dad are getting ready to go to work, mama takes a long time, and after a little while, my dad says, Jesus Christ, when are you going to get out of there? And so that kind of laid-back attitude rubs off on kids. But when you look at Moses' life, he was a man, his parents were, they were people of priority. They were people of faith. But number three, they depended on God's grace. You say, wait, preacher, where'd you get that from? If you went and hid your child in some bushes in a river, and this passage doesn't cover that. If you want to go to Exodus 2 and read about it, you get it there. Then those people basically had to trust God's grace to take care of them. Now, as I mentioned a moment ago, we had a son that was a missionary in China, and I try not to say this too much because it makes it, you know, look like I'm bragging or something, but here, and this is a very impactful story, but when our son was 12 years old, he ran away from home on his go-kart. Then he was 16, he got his first car, and within 2 weeks, he got two tickets for driving over 80 miles an hour. And if you'd have known that kid back then and known him what he turned out to be, you'd have had to say, only by the grace of God. Moms and dads, you're not going to get it right. Y'all who came today, can I just encourage you? Your baby may give you fits at some point. But what we have to do with everything in our lives, our children, our marriage, our homes, our job, everything about life, we have to just come before God and say, God, I give you my life by grace that you would take care of it. Now put yourself in Moses' parents' shoes. The king was threatened to kill all the boy babies. They hid him for 3 months, and then she realized she couldn't get the job done. So she builds this little small, I'll call it a boat, and put Moses in it. All you can say about that, except for the grace of God. Those of you who are older parents, would you say it with me, as a parent, only by the grace of God will my kids come out right. Is that right? Amen? And so today what I do in this point of time, I lift up the grace of God. In just a minute, we're going to baptize 3 men. There's not one of those 3 men that's perfect. There's not one of those 3 men who doesn't have struggles with lust and anger and pride, just like I and the other man in this room does. There's only one reason why we can come and baptize them today. It's because the grace of God smiled down on them and God sent His Son, Jesus Christ, to die in their place on the cross that they might be saved today. And so it should be the dream, the desire, the goal of everybody in this room that we give our hearts to God and open our hands up to Him and say, Lord, except for Your grace, I'd spend eternity in hell. You parents, except for the grace of God, you will not be able to raise those children, but His grace will cover up your mistakes and your weaknesses and your failures. And that happened in Moses' life, that happened. And I had a friend over in Louisiana years ago. I heard that this young man was coming to sing at our church. He was a first cousin of mine. And when the music directors told us that Ronnie, that was his name, was coming to sing for us, I thought, how can he sing? He's got a major stuttering problem. And that night, Ronnie walked up to that pulpit and he stuttered, a severe stuttering problem. But he stood there in the presence of that congregation and he sang without ever missing a syllable. I thought, except for the grace of God, could Ronnie do that? And friends, that's what I want to encourage you in today, as a parent, as a person, that apart from the grace of God, you'll never achieve what you want to achieve. Apart from the grace of God, you'll never be born again. Apart from the grace of God, You'll never have a strong marriage. There's people in this room who've been married over 50 years. Those of you who've been married over 50 years, except for the grace of God, you wouldn't have made it, had you. And there's others in this room today who, school teachers, coaches, unless God's grace enables you with what you're struggling with, you'll never make it. You'll never get by. Now, I'm going to do something today that's a little bit different than, we're going to have an invitation. I'm going to step out in just a minute. But I want to ask the 3 men that we're about to baptize to come up here and stand by me just a second. And then I'm going to dismiss them upstairs in just a minute. These 3 men, I've been pastoring 46 years. And this is the first time I've baptized 3 men in the same service like I'm doing today. This is Kenneth. This is Papa Jake, and this is Stephen. And I said, guys, would y'all mind if I just kind of brag on you? I said, the fact that 3 men would come and first they've confessed Christ as Lord and Savior, but then to be baptized in the water as men, that's awesome. Let's give them a hand. All right. You guys can be dismissed to wherever you put your towel and your items at, and we come to celebrate with you in just a second. Now, congregation, if y'all would stand, please. Stacy, are you doing an invitation? Okay. Stacy's going to lead us in what I call the prayer of invitation. And every time we have a service, we ask people to consider what's God speaking to them about. What's He leading them to do? For some, it's to confess Christ as Lord and accept Him by the grace of God. For some, it's to move their membership to be a part of this church family. Sometimes, maybe couples come and kneel around the front here and pray together. But while I'm getting ready to baptize these three guys, Stacy's going to lead you in singing a song. If you want to just pray, that's fine. Tyler is here to guide you in any decision you might be thinking about making. After we've done this invitation song, Elena is going to come and sing, right? Okay. And she got her hands full today. She's got a husband to be baptized and a baby. Look at all the family she's got over here. That's good. And in fact, I didn't do that well. How many family are here with the Sullivans today? Y'all raise your hand. Okay. And how many are the Carlisles? I know there's several of y'all here. And the Tuckers back here have several family members. So we congratulate y'all and thank y'all for coming today. So while I'm getting ready and the men are getting ready, we'll have the invitation. Then Elena's going to come and sing. And then by then we'll be ready and we'll all celebrate together. We're having a party today for these who have come to confess Christ. Let's sing, Stacy.
Take up thy cross and follow me. I heard my master say, I gave my life to ransom thee. So precious memories, unseen angels sent from somewhere to my soul. How they linger ever near me, and the sacred past unfold. Precious memories, how they linger, how they ever flood my soul. In the stillness of the midnight, precious sacred scenes unfold. Precious Father, loving Mother, fly across the lonely years. And old home scenes of my childhood, in fond memory.
precious memories, how they linger, how they ever flood my soul. In the stillness of the midnight, precious sacred scenes unfold. As I travel on life's pathway, know not what the years may hold. As I ponder, hope grows fonder, precious memories flood my soul. Precious memories, how they linger, how they ever flood my soul. In the stillness of the midnight, precious sacred scenes unfold. Precious sacred scenes unfold.
We're going to have a revival. We have many more services like this, aren't we? Thank you for that, Elena. Stephen, have you asked Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your Lord and Savior?
Yes, sir, I have.
Then I baptize you today because of your obedience to Him and following Him in baptism. Many people can say they were baptized the same day as their baby was dedicated. Jake, if you ask Jesus Christ to come into your life to be your Lord and only Savior,
absolutely.
Then because of your faith in Him and obedient to His command, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son, the Holy Spirit. Have you asked Jesus Christ to come into your life and save you and to be your Lord and Savior?
Yes, I have.
Then today, because of your faith and obedience to His commands, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son, the Holy Spirit.
All right, let's pray together. Dear Lord, thank you for the example that we've seen here this morning of your love and redemption on our lives. Lord, I thank you for your Spirit being here with us in this service today, for the children who were dedicated and their families that are represented here. I thank you for the men that have just shown what it means to sacrifice their life for you, to truly surrender to you. Lord, I pray that if there's someone here this morning that doesn't have a relationship with you, that they've seen your glory and your redemption this morning through this service. Lord, I thank you for the example that you put before us. In your name I pray. Amen. So I have a few announcements for us. On April the 1st, we're having our volunteer fire department. We're feeding them. If you're interested in helping with that, if you will see Jackie Spence, I think there's also a sign-up sheet in the lobby for that. The other thing is on April the 8th from 10 to 12, we're having our Easter egg hunt here, and we're really trying to reach out and minister to the families in our community during this time. So if you're interested in helping with that, Miss Gina O'Hanlon is in charge of that. What can people do right now to help with that? Okay, so we still need candy that's small enough to fit in eggs, if you can bring that. And that is on, the day of that Easter egg hunt is April the 8th from 10 to 12. And then at the end of April, April 29th, we're having a free yard sale. Please continue to bring those things that you would like to donate to be able to give to our community. Those can be brought to the gym. And then for the men's ministry, on May the 6th at 5 p.m., there's going to be a fish fry here in the fellowship hall. That's May the 6th at 5 p.m. There's going to be a time of fellowship and also testimony during that. And there's a sign-up sheet in the foyer. So the fish fry is May the 6th at 5 p.m. for the men. Does anyone else have a prayer request or announcement to add to this? Yes, ma'am.